Yeah, I like what Aki said. It's not a conclusion, it's a commencement. Because our faith never ends. Our life of faith never ends. So whenever my mom likes to say, when you think you've finished growing in something, all that means is now you're back at the bottom of the next stage. You have to climb all the way up. Before I start, I was praying this morning and I found this quote Reverend Moon said in 1972, talking about Christianity in the United States. And just to preface concluding divine principle, because, yeah, I'll just read it. It says, he said in 1972, there is only one God, one Christ, one Bible. Today, however, in the Christian world alone, there are more than 400 different denominations, all looking at the same Bible from very different points of view, with many different interpretations. What we are interested in today is not the human interpretation of the Bible, but how God interprets the Bible, and what God's will really is. That answer must come from God in the form of revelation. And what is God's perspective on the Bible? What is God's perspective on the world? Well, it all started when he began his creation. And he created the creation because he wanted to experience joy through love. So he created the entire universe through a long course, science says billions and billions of years. And then he designed human beings several billion years ago, and they've evolved over time. And God's intention was for human beings to go through a three-stage growing process of formation, growth, and completion, so that they can fulfill what Genesis 1:28 calls the three great blessings: to be fruitful, to mature oneself through unity between mind and body centered on God, to multiply, have a relationship with another human being to create an ideal family centered on God, and to bring the whole creation in relationship with human beings centered on God, so that then, through human beings, the entire creation can become a good object partner for God. And this is done through what the Divine Principle calls the four-position foundation. And this was God's intention. But because it's supposed to, this four-position foundation and relationships are always built on love, it needs to be a free choice. So that's why God didn't directly govern us when we were going through these three stages of growth. And this was the case for the first human ancestors, Adam and Eve. And to help them, though, through this indirect period, God did give them a commandment: do not eat the fruit. In other words, don't have a relationship with another person or go to the second blessing before you've completed the first blessing. But one of God's creations, the archangel Lucifer, felt jealous at the love that God was giving Adam and Eve as human beings compared to himself, and tempted Adam and Eve to form a four-position foundation with him. And they did so. And this four-position foundation wasn't based on selflessness or living for the sake of others, stuff that true love is really about. In fact, it was based on Lucifer, who then became the entity known as Satan, his desire to selfishly take through his jealousy and envy that he felt of Adam and Eve. And because Adam and Eve succumbed to his temptation, they created a four-position foundation centered on him, centered on selfishness, jealousy, all the emotions and proclivities that led to the succumbing to Satan's temptation. And this is what we call hell on earth. In other words, a world where there's conflict, a world where there's war, a world where there's confusion, and we're struggling because we have ended up in this midway position where Satan can now kind of influence us because of his ties to us through spiritual lineage, through the fall of man. But also, God, as our heavenly parent, created us. And since he's our parent, and he's the ideal and utmost example of being a parent, having parental love and giving love and receiving love, he's not just going to give up on us and throw his children away. Which is why he immediately commenced the providence of restoration through various central figures, which we've talked about in part two of the Divine Principle, like Abel, Noah, Abraham and his family, Moses, and then finally to build up towards the Messiah, Jesus, who will be a being that God sends to earth based on a foundation of faith, which is doing what Adam and Eve should have done in the Garden of Eden by obeying God's commandment, and by restoring the foundation of substance, which is developing our true nature rather than succumbing to fallen nature, which was derived from Satan. And this foundation for the Messiah is needed, because if God's going to send an ultimate example so that through the Messiah and him finding a bride, we can be going through what Adam and Eve could not and finishing our growing process, if he and his bride are supposed to model that and do what Adam and Eve should have done, if they come and we're not at the level spiritually to understand or receive what God's trying to say through that person, we're just going to brand him as, you know, kind of like the Jewish people did, as we talked about, as a heretic, as someone who's just a lower class person, a carpenter's boy, and they would misunderstand him. They wouldn't receive what he had to say. So that's why God was trying to establish this foundation for the Messiah through central figures, which raise the level of spirituality and morality so that we can eventually receive him. But even so, it's still our portion of responsibility. And this is why Jesus was crucified on the cross, because human beings at that time did not fulfill that responsibility. But Jesus, being this ideal man who completed the perfection of his individual character, never lost faith in God. He never lost sight of the fact that God is his parent and Jesus is God's child. And so because of that, even though Satan used every bit of power to defeat Jesus and work through people to crucify him, God was able to use his maximum power to raise Jesus up through the resurrection of Easter Sunday and gives spiritual rebirth through the Holy Spirit. And this is the phenomenon that millions of Christians has testified to, where they are inspired by the Holy Spirit to believe in Jesus and his teachings, and their spirit grows ever so closer to God. But as St. Paul famously said when preaching about Jesus shortly after his death, even though our spirits can go closer to God and are not necessarily shackled by Satan, our bodies are still liable to Satan's attack, because this example that would bring us through the completion stage and the engrafting and removal of our original sin, which came from the fall, which came from the archangel Lucifer, it wasn't done on earth. We need, because according to the principle of creation, it's not just our bodies that are growing on earth, it's our spirits that are growing on earth. And when we die, we are, the only way we can grow completely is to come back to earth. So this example needs to be done on the earth, which is why Jesus, throughout the later half of his ministry, prophesied that he would come again as the second advent and find a bride and complete the providence of salvation. And we've been studying after this point that God has been, throughout history actually, trying to prepare the environment, even after Jesus' death, through the history of Christianity. And what we've discovered and seen, and it's not just the divine principle, but of course many historians have pointed this out, that history moves in a spiral and repeats itself. And people have not quite understood why, but the reason is because in the process of restoration, in other words, reversing what went wrong, you have to go back. Meaning that if something fails, you have to go back even further. And that's why parallels of history have formed with similar historical ages with similar lengths, especially between the Israelites and the Christians. And also God has been preparing an environment where the Messiah, when he comes again as the second advent, won't have a likelihood of dying. There will be an environment of democracy, like the divine principle talked about, where it's hard to censor someone or kill someone for what they're saying or who they claim to be or what they're trying to do. So that is what has led us to our discussion today and the last chapter of the divine principle. Because we've established that God is trying to complete his providence on earth, and that for that to happen, there needs to be a second coming of the Messiah. But there's a lot of confusion in the Bible, in the Christian scripture, and even in scriptures and other faiths about when will this person come? How will they come? Where will they come from? Who will it be? How can we even determine or figure it out? Because in Jesus' day, it was very hard for people to figure it out. So that's what this chapter talks about. So we're going to answer those questions today, now that I've given a short recap of everything we've studied so far in such a short amount of time. So the first question is, when will the second advent come? Now, the divine principle so far has established that today is the last days, through analyzing it through various lenses, through the lens of restoring the three great blessings, through the raising of our spirituality, morality, through the various central figures that God has been sending throughout history, and through the parallels of history. And in the parallels of history, the divine principle mentioned how there is always a period of preparation for the second advent of the Messiah. In the Israelites' time, it was, or actually even beforehand, with the time of Jacob, it was the period when they were establishing the family foundation for the Messiah. And then 400 years before Jesus' birth, this period began with the prophet Malachi, who was telling the people that that the Messiah would be coming, and you need to prepare yourselves. You need to prepare for the coming of the Lord. And then likewise, this preparation period in Christian history began in 1517, where a man named Martin Luther called out the corruption of the Christian church and the believers at that time, to call them to prepare themselves to receive the second advent through studying the Bible on your own, breaking free of just pure dogma. And one of his major qualms, of course, was the dogma of indulgences, which had very little to do with the Bible. He was calling them to prepare themselves and search in the spirit and truth to prepare for the second advent. So 400 years later is 1917. But when we add these parallel periods all together, 400 plus 400 plus 120 plus 400 plus 210, and then the 400-year period of preparation for the second advent of the Messiah, we get 1930. Now, this means that the divine principle is saying that the Messiah either will come soon or has already come. And we cannot throw out the possibility by any stretch that the Messiah and the second advent has already come again. Because in Jesus' time, for most people in Judea, they didn't know he was born. And then as he grew up, all he was known for is being the son of a carpenter and an uneducated man. And then when he started his public ministry, all he was known for as a heretic. The Romans just thought of him as a rebel. And the Jewish leadership and Romans collaborated to kill him. But even after that, even though Jesus' disciples were preaching about the gospel and who Jesus was, some of Judea still didn't know. And didn't even know who he was. And the Romans, they didn't even know who Jesus was until Paul went to Rome. And even after that, they didn't know that he was such a special man, because they would persecute Christians, and they persecuted them for hundreds and hundreds of years. It took until 392 until they were even recognized as a religion. So it can take hundreds of years for people to understand who someone is. Same with, you know, historical figures when you study history. People wouldn't have expected that Christopher Columbus was this amazing or controversial or sometimes awful man until they've studied him in full. They've looked at his whole character and this whole series of events. That happened several decades later. Before then, he was just a guy sent by the Spanish monarchy to go find the Americas, or actually find India, but he landed in America. He didn't really realize that point. But anyways, in short, we can't throw out that possibility that he may have already come. Now, the next question then is how he will come. Because in the Bible specifically, and in other religious faiths, there are prophecies which detail how this second advent will come. And in the Bible, there's prophecies where he will come from the heavens on the clouds, escorted by a whole parade of angels. And there's prophecies that he will return as a child born on the earth. Now, how are we to figure that out? Because we can't just say, we can't just throw out one set of prophecies and be like, God didn't inspire that. Like, that's not how it works. We can't just throw out the Bible or throw out any religious scripture just because it doesn't fit our understanding or our preconceived notions. I'll go back to the quote from Levin Moon where he said, we have to be open-minded and be interested in God's interpretation of the Bible, not our human understanding. But we're lucky that we've deduced so far that the Bible is coded in a bunch of symbolism. So let's first analyze the prophecies that Jesus is coming as a child. First, Jesus himself was born as a child. He was born from the Virgin Mother Mary. He didn't come on the clouds. And even the returning Elijah, who was John the Baptist, the Jewish people thought that he was coming on the clouds in a fiery chariot. But in reality, through the principle of returning resurrection, which we've studied, Elijah returned in the form of John the Baptist, who was to complete his mission. And the Jewish people were looking at the clouds for these type of people. But in reality, they were born on earth. And while they recognized that John the Baptist was someone special, they didn't recognize that Jesus was someone special, because he was just a regular man born on the earth. So from that angle, we can see that Jesus would return as a child on the earth. But there are several quotes of his which also can support the notion that he will come as a child on earth. For example, in Revelation chapter 16, he said that, "Lo, I am coming like a thief, not on the clouds, not with a bunch of angels, no, like a thief hiding in the night." And then in Luke chapter 17, when he's talking to the Pharisees, he expresses something very interesting. And I'm going to read the whole paragraph and think what he said. Luke chapter 17, starting at verse 20. "Being asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God was coming, he answered them, 'The kingdom of God is not coming with signs to be observed, nor will they say, Lo, here it is, or there. For behold, the kingdom of God is in the midst of you.' And he said to his disciples, 'The days are coming when you will desire to see one of the days of the Son of Man, and you will not see it. And they will say to you, Lo there, lo here. Do not go, do not follow them. For as the lightning flashes up in the sky from one side to the other, so will the Son of Man be in his day. But first he must suffer many things and be rejected by this generation. As it was in the days of Noah, so will it be in the days of the Son of Man.'" So there's a lot there, but Jesus is warning his disciples that when he comes again, people might not recognize him. People might not recognize that the kingdom of God is coming. He will seem commonplace from the common eye. And he wants them also to remember that just because they're born as a child on the earth, it might be some ordinary person, don't just follow anyone who says, "I'm the Messiah." We talked about in the last chapter on preparation for the second advent that antichrists occur in the last days. People like Kaiser Wilhelm, Hitler, Stalin, they all thought of themselves as some messianic leader. They thought they were the ones who would lead their people. Hitler thought that he would save the German people by ridding them of the Jews. Obviously, he was not the Messiah at all, but people treated him as a messianic figure. Same with Stalin. The communist theory, according to him, was that, the new age of history is coming, and this is why we're commencing, you know, the five-year plan and putting people who wouldn't obey in the gulags. He was a messianic figure to some Russians at that time. But obviously, he was the complete antithesis of what the Messiah is to do, which is bring people together centered on God, not some satanic imitation. But if we know he will come as a child through various things Jesus said and the prophecy surrounding his second advent, why then, in some places, such as Revelation chapter 1, does it say, "Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, everyone who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen." Now that's strange, because 12 chapters later, Revelation also says, "She brought forth a male child, one is to rule all the nations with a rod of iron." So two conflicting prophecies. Now, we can take it literally, or like the rest of the Bible, and especially prophecies. Prophecies in particular are never literal. We have to deduce what it means by the clouds. So first, let's answer like how he's coming. It says, or who he's coming to. It says, "Everyone who pierced him." Now, if he's warning about the followers of Christianity at the time of the second advent, he's warning people he might come to people who might want to pierce him, just like the Romans and Jewish leaders did. But who is he coming to? He will be born as a child coming on the clouds. Now, what do clouds mean in the Bible? To understand that, we have to understand what water means, because water is what makes up a cloud. Water in the Bible is consistently the symbol of rebirth of fallen people, or people who are under the influence of Satan. And by becoming on the clouds, Jesus is saying he will be coming again to a group of people that have been spiritually reborn through what Jesus called the water of life in his ministry. "I'm coming with the water of life. Drink and you will never thirst," he kept saying. So that's what the clouds mean. He's coming to a group of reborn spiritual Christian believers. as a child born on the earth. And there's even another reason why he has to be a child on earth, from the principle of creation, like we talked about. For him to come again, he can't come as a spirit, which is why his Easter Sunday resurrection and the Pentecost and all that, that was Jesus coming as a spirit. He still needed to come again as a human being born on the earth who will complete his mission and give physical rebirth as well as spiritual rebirth. So with all that, we've understood that when he might come and how the second advent might come. So now the question comes, where will he come? Because we know he will come on the earth, so thank goodness. I mean, the Bible and the divine principle aren't necessarily talking about aliens, so we can throw that out the window maybe. But where will he come? And a big key to understanding this question is the famous parable he gave, which was the parable of the vineyard. And I'm not going to read the whole thing, but the conclusion of his parable says in Matthew chapter 21, verse 43, he says, "Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a nation producing the fruits of it." And this is important because many people have assumed that he will come to the nation of Israel and the Jewish people again. But Jesus is saying here that actually the kingdom of God and the title of Israel might be taken away. Now, to understand why he's saying that, we need to understand what Israel means. Because Israel is not just the name of the nation state of the Jewish people. Israel is the name given to Jacob, if we remember from his course, that after he wrestled the angel into throughout the night, right before meeting his brother Esau, he wrestled him through the night and he demanded that the angel tell him, give him a blessing. And then the angel's blessing to him was the name Israel, which literally means one who struggles victoriously with God and one who triumphs in their faith. So in other words, if you've ever listened to Jordan Peterson, he talks a lot about the nation of Israel, the meaning of Israel and struggling with God. But essentially, it's talking about how it is the name and title given to those who are successful in overcoming the struggles in their faith. Now, in Matthew chapter 3, John the Baptist, as Jesus was beginning his ministry, was telling the Jewish people, quote, "Do not presume to say to yourself, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham." So in other words, it is not the right way of looking at it to say, oh, if you are Jewish and you are descended lineally from Abraham, you're automatically the people that the second advent will come to. And we know for a fact that God has raised up new chosen people throughout history, even in Israel's history. For example, when the Israelites complained after the 40-day spy mission, God told Moses that the first generation of Israelites would not enter Canaan. They would die in the wilderness, and God would work through the second generation of Israelites. And then centuries later, during the divided kingdom of Israel, when the northern kingdom refused to repent, even after the works of Elijah the prophet, God allowed the Assyrians to completely wipe them out. In the history books, they're called the 10 lost tribes of Israel. People don't even know where they are anymore. I read somewhere too that it's very rare to even find a Jewish person that's descended from any of these 10 tribes. But even later, after Jesus' death, the two remaining tribes, Judah and Benjamin, several decades after Jesus' death, Jerusalem was wiped out. Judea was wiped out. The whole nation of Israel and the people of Israel were scattered for almost 2,000 years. They didn't even have a nation until 1948, soon after the end of World War II. So who was given the title of Israel then, if God took it away from the Jewish people? He did give them to a select few Jews, the Jews who were following Jesus, Jesus' initial disciples, which means that Christians inherited the title of Israel. In the divine principle, they're called the second Israel. And that is where the second advent will come. Now, despite all that, yeah, we know the group of people, but we still don't know where, because Christians are all over the earth at this point. They have spread out to every corner of the earth. I mean, I'm not saying Antarctica, so maybe. I don't know about that. So we still have to answer the question where, but at least we know what group of people. We've confirmed that it is the Christians, right? And we've talked about people reborn of Jesus and all that, but even more confirmation of that. So now we turn to the book of Revelation once again. Revelation chapter 5, the beginning of it, in this very famous, very obscure prophecy about the seven sealed scrolls. I'm going to read directly from it. It says, "And I saw on the right hand of him who was seated on the throne a scroll written, and on the back sealed with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaim it with a loud voice, 'Who is worthy to open the scrolls and break its seals?' And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look into it. And I wept that no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it." So I'm going to pause for a second. The seven, so basically the prophecy saying that someone needs to come and open this scroll that is sealed with seven seals. And the follower of Jesus, John, who wrote this book, the book of Revelation, is saying he's crying because he can't find anyone to open to it. Now I'm going to continue reading. "Then one of the elders said to me, 'Weep not. Lo, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered, so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals.'" So the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, are symbols in the Bibles for Jesus. So the second advent, when he comes, will open this scroll of seven seals. And from the divine principle's perspective, this scroll sealed with seven seals is the new truth that the divine principle keeps mentioning that the second advent must give to the group of Christians he comes to. That is part of his mission, and how we'll know that whoever's the second advent is the second advent, because they are giving a truth that's not contradicting the New Testament, but is adding to it and fulfilling it. And then two chapters later, in chapter 7, Revelation reads, "Then I saw another angel ascending from the rising sun with the seal of the living God, and he called with a loud voice to the four angels who had been given power to harm the earth and sea, saying, 'Do not harm the earth or the sea or the trees till we have sealed the servants of our God upon their foreheads.'" So in other words, this angel is coming from the place where the sun rises, telling the other angels, no, wait, we have found the group of Christians that the second advent will come to, and where he will open the scroll sealed with seven seals. Now I'm going to keep reading. The last part of it says, "And I heard the number of the sealed, 144,000 sealed." So the prophecy is saying that the second advent is going to open the scroll sealed with seven seals to a group of elected Christians. It says 144,000. Now, the angel is telling them, the angel is the one who is saying he'll come here. Where is the angel in this prophecy? The rising sun is where the east is. So we have a clue. Come to the east. Now, east in reference to what? This room, you know, somewhere? Well, if the Christians are spread out throughout the world, and the angel is coming to earth, in the prophecy, the place it's referring to is the whole earth, not just a specific place. So in the context of the earth, it is the east, the eastern hemisphere. And in the time of John's writing of the book of Revelation and the understanding of the world at that time, the East meant the Asian continent. And at this time, Rome had some sort of contact with, you know, the borders of China, but not much beyond that. So this was a completely unknown part of the world. Now, throughout the East history, or Asia's history, there have been three consistent nations over the course of thousands of years: China, Japan, and Korea. Now, the first deduce what one might be the nation that, or the territory that the second advent will come to. Let's analyze each nation's group of people and their faith practice, because that is what the prophecy and the Bible has all been talking about. It's not necessarily, oh, this piece of land has this type of soil and God has blessed it, and it's nothing like that. It's about the people and the faith of that place. So in China's history, there have never been Christians in China. Not many. Until maybe very, very, very recently. And even so, very minuscule. In fact, when China was dealing with Europe and the Americas in the 17th, 18th, 19th centuries, they had a strict policy of closed borders. They didn't let any influence in. They thought the West was like, would corrupt them basically and undermine their culture. And so they had very few trade agreements with Western countries at that time. And because of that, there was no Christian influence or access in China. And then in the mid 20th century, we got Maoist communism, which, as we know, communism is an ideology that completely denies God, and from the divine principles perspective, is Satan's last attempt to prevent the second advent from being successful by denying God, denying the spirit world, anything that would even remotely have a consideration of the second advent, which is one other reason why we got Antichrist in places like the Soviet Union with Stalin. But in any case, and in China with Mao Zedong, you could argue he was also an Antichrist in his actions, thinking he was the savior and using that same communist ideology. But that's not what the divine principle talks about. But what it does talk about is that China cannot be this nation. Now let's look at Japan. Now Japan, and we have to analyze all these countries in the time when the second advent might come, which is the early 20th century. Japan at this time was a nation trying to make its name a name of itself with the world powers, such as Russia and America and Britain. And they were, like the rest of those type of countries, an imperialist nation. And they would try and colonize parts of, I think, Manchuria, Mongolia, some parts close to China, and also Korea. And I should note too that China, throughout its 5,000-6,000 year history, has always been at odds with Korea as well. But in any case, in addition to that, Japan at this time was not only, you know, in terms of the spiritual practice of that time, they were worshiping not Christianity, but another faith which worshiped chiefly the sun goddess, and I'm so sorry if I pronounced this wrong, Ametusaru Omikami. Did I say that right, Sam, on Hiroko? No? Okay. That is the English pronunciation of this goddess. But in any case, they not only did that, but when they were occupying Korea beginning in 1905, they would persecute Christians. They would persecute the people of the Second Israel. So because of that, they could not stand as a nation where the Second Advent could come. They were persecuting the people that they would come to. So now we have Korea. Now Korea has not had Christians through most of its history until the 19th century, where Christian missionaries began going to Korea. And by the time of the early 20th century, there were a large number of Christians, both mainstream and more fringe groups. And like I just mentioned, they were persecuted under the hands of the Japanese, the imperial, the army that was occupying Korea. So now, sure, we've narrowed it down to Korea, but what else makes them the nation that the Second Advent could come to? Because, I mean, let's take Israel, for example. They had so much hardship, so much tribulation, so many central figures sent to them. And same with Christianity, all the martyrdom, all the persecution. What could lead Korea, this nation that at this point in time was only considered valuable because of its status as a peninsula on the edge of the Pacific Ocean? That's why these countries would vie for control over it. They wanted that strategic place. What qualifies them beyond, some countries thought it was important? Firstly, when we look at parallels of history, the first Israel and the Christians both had to endure a period of separation from Satan in order to stand as people who could fulfill God's providence. This is what's called, and I'm going to abbreviate it here, a dispensation of 40 for the separation of Satan. And in the history of Israel, we saw that it was their 400-year period of slavery and oppression in Egypt. And after they endured that period, God could call Moses to complete God's providence to lay the national foundation for the Messiah, like we talked about in part two. Fast forwarding to the time after Jesus, Christians experienced a 400-year period of persecution as well. From the time he died and the disciples of Jesus kept preaching the good news of the gospel until it was finally recognized, first by Emperor Constantine, giving it some toleration, and then Theodosius in 392, the Roman emperor, giving it status as an official religion. And like they talked about, it was very misunderstood before that time. Korea also endured a 40-year period of occupation and tribulation. And this was the 40-year occupation by Japan, beginning in 1905 with the Osa Treaty of Protection, which was a result of the Russo-Japanese War. It's a very fascinating piece of history. If you want to read about it, it's very interesting about how Japan became such an important nation in the world. That was a big part of it. But in any case, they began annexing Korea with the Osa Treaty of Protection in 1905, and then in 1910 they completed the annexation, and they were under occupation where Christians were persecuted. Korean culture was censored in a way. Levin Moon even states, because he lived during this time, that they forced Koreans to adopt Japanese names. But among this also, the people leading the independence movement were largely Christian. Actually, Reverend Moon's wife, Hak Jahan Moon, her grandmother was actually a chief part of the March 1st demonstrations, which is a very famous event that occurred in this movement. So they endured a 40-year period trying to separate from Satan through hardship and oppression. And it ended in 1945 with the defeat of Japan in World War II, as well as the other Axis powers. Now, the second criteria that Korea met was it became God and Satan's front line. Now, what do I mean by front line? Well, in the history of Israel, one of the reasons why it was so difficult for them to fulfill their responsibility is because God was trying to work through central figures to move his providence forward, and Satan was trying with all his might and every condition to try and undermine that. And this struggle was very intense throughout Israel's history. Even in Israel's history, there was a period where the kingdom was divided into the north, which eventually fell to Satan, and the south, which God was able to salvage in the end and create the place of Judea. And in Christianity too, we've seen tremendous development and, you know, wars and conflict and divides and division in Christian history as well. And God and Satan have been working very hard in those efforts. You know, major events in world history, major good things and major evil things have happened because of the struggle between God and Satan in Christian history. Likewise, after Korea was liberated from the occupation, immediately, and it's very confounding how this happened in historical realms, but a few years later, Korea was divided by the 38th parallel, very famous, into North Korea and South Korea. And it wasn't that just that they were divided. North Korea at this time, beginning in around 1948, was being given tremendous help from the USSR and also China. Both USSR, Soviet Russia was definitely extremely communist, and China was becoming communist as well. And this is a representative of Satan kind of using the North of Korea. And then eventually, there became a civil war called the Korean War, where the North Korean army, backed by Chinese and Soviet troops, was battling the South, which was striving for democracy. And they were backed by not only the US, but 16 UN nations to this tiny little peninsula. In just a few years, all the major powers of the world, right after World War II, descended upon this peninsula and engaged in a fierce battle. And for the South, this was a representative of God. We read in preparation, the last chapter, that democracy is the able type view of life representing God, and then this communist side is Satan's side in the Cain position. And so this became God and Satan's front line, because if the Second Advent is going to be born in this area, then of course, not only is God going to want to protect it, but Satan is like this, just like he was with Jesus. I need to eliminate this threat no matter what, no matter what. And this was Satan's way of trying to do so. Now, what this did is it gave them another qualification, because through the occupation and the Korean War, they became the object partners to God's heart. Because God's heart, throughout providential history, we've seen it. It's not just a bunch of glory and a bunch of rays of sunshine. It is pain. It is sorrow. It is destruction. It requires war with his own children. That's what it takes for him to accomplish his dream, because he knows that what he has in mind for us is infinitely more powerful and important than Satan's selfish desires for us. So he sacrifices and sacrifices, and sometimes has to pit his children against each other and let Satan control some parts of humanity. But because Korea endured, and especially the Christians in Korea, never lost their faith, they didn't just give up, even though they were only there for 100 years, Christianity was only there for 100 years. No, they kept the faith. They kept the faith, they kept conviction in God, and especially groups that were receiving revelations that the Second Advent would come here kept their faith throughout this tribulation. They became object partners to God's heart. They understood God's heart at this time, probably more than any other group of Christians at this time. Because not only in Europe, in any case, what I mentioned about people receiving revelations that the second advent would come was in part because Korea, like many other faiths and religions, had messianic prophecies. In the 14th century, there's this very interesting book called the Cheongnam-gok, and I haven't studied it personally, although I should, but it talks, from what I know and what the divine principle says, it talks about a prophecy of a righteous king who's going to found an everlasting kingdom in Korea. And this guy, this messianic figure, is called the Cheongdeureom. I hope I said that right. There's no one, does anyone speak Korean here? Korean here, Mom? You've been studying it. Is that the same? Okay. Well, it literally means the one who comes with the true word of God. So they also have a messianic prophecy. And it's not just those type of prophecies. In this time, and historians have been really confounded about this as well, there are spiritual groups at this time like popping up everywhere, especially in North Korea. It wasn't North Korea at that time, but the northern, what we now know as North Korea, many spiritual groups were receiving revelations that the second advent would come. They kept receiving these revelations that, for example, Pyongyang is like the Jerusalem in the east. And remember, we have to remember, this is before the divide between North Korea and South Korea. And that the second advent is coming and that you need to prepare. So these spiritual groups would literally make physical preparations. They would make clothing for them. They would bow to Jesus' picture. They would not acquiesce to Japanese forcing them to bow to the direction of the imperial palace. They wouldn't do it. And this is because they fervently believe that the second advent would come to this land amidst all the oppression, amidst all the confusion. And one last note that the Divine Principle gives as a interesting look at how Korea is this place where the second advent will come is that even anthropologically, Korea is only just becoming this powerhouse of civilization, if you will. In the beginning, anthropologically, humans originated in Africa, then they moved to Europe, which is a more like, you know, Africa very hot, then Europe, more fall type weather, and then at the same time moving through Asia. And then Europeans came to the Americas around 400, 500 years ago. And then the people who migrated through Asia came to America 13,000 years ago through the Bering Strait. And as we know, America, very tough winter, all these things. But now, recently, it's almost like, and we first saw this when all the world powers came to Korea's aid on both sides. Korea is this place where there is tremendous technological development. I mean, we think America's infrastructure is good. I mean, go to Korea. Their hotels are something else. The elevators are fast, which I like. They have tremendous trains in Korea, as well as places like China, Japan, those monorails. They have tremendous infrastructure. The cultural phenomenon is pretty amazing, how only maybe 60, 70 years after this tragic war, after 40 years of occupation, and it's just in the rabble, everyone's poor, American military is trying to bring them off their feet, that a few decades later, they are now like one of the most advanced countries in the world. There's a statistic out there which says they're like the 13th biggest economy in the world. Tremendous, tremendous, and puzzling like development in Korea. So through all these qualifications that reflect the qualifications that both the Israelites and the Christians in Europe had to go through, these are all these qualifications that give Korea the status of being this place in the Far East that the Book of Revelation talks about. And, you know, something else interesting too is that it's not just my mom that's studying Korean, or maybe people in our movement, just because some of the Divine Principle was originally written in Korean. A lot of more people are studying Korean because it is a place where a lot of culture happens, and also a lot of political turmoil happens. Whenever Kim Jong-un stirs up something about nuclear weapons, all the world powers that go here. It's like they send China and the USSR and Russia, they send representatives to Kim Jong-un, the South, the US sends an ambassador to Korea, they're meeting there. There's tons of stuff going on here. And it's reflective of this prophecy that the second advent may come to Korea. But we can't repeat the mistakes of the past. That's the whole point that Jesus was trying to make when he would say he's coming like a thief, coming like a child. And one other thing Jesus did too is he gave this, you know, revelation that he'll come in the clouds as a symbol, not just because he wanted to keep the consistency of the Bible or whatever with a bunch of symbols, but also so that it's not, people aren't confused. Because like I said earlier, like a child on the earth, like anyone could claim that they're the second advent, literally anyone. Oh, I'm a child born on the earth, I'm a Christian, you know, I'm faithful, you know, I have this mission now, like follow me. Like, I mean, we've seen the extreme with antichrists, like Kaiser, Hitler, and Stalin. But he's trying to make sure we're not confused, but at the same time, not repeat the mistakes of the past and not potentially not recognize him as the second advent. And the Divine Principle says about Christianity in particular on page 407 that many leading clergymen and priests are captive to their authorities and enamored of their rituals while their spirits grow deeper and deeper each day. Hence, devout Christians are wandering about the mountains and plains in search of the true path. So basically what the Divine Principle is saying is that, yes, tradition is important. Yes, our day-to-day routines are important. Yes, our life of faith habits that, you know, whether they're rooted in the Bible directly or not are important, they may be a block to recognize or receive the second advent and the new truth he will bring to complete the word of the New and Old Testaments. Just like the Jewish people. I mean, for them, it was like, oh, we finally got things down. They finally got their faith down, it seemed. After all the hundreds of years of wavering, worship the gods of Baal, you know, going through like all these crazy things, Solomon's like 900 wives, all that. They finally got it down, and then God's like, ah, yeah, we're gonna change, we're gonna add a new level. We're gonna add, like my mom always says, oh, you're up here? Okay, now you're at the bottom. Good luck. And that was a big part of why it was difficult for the people of Jesus' time to recognize him. Because not only that, he was someone they didn't expect. They expected someone from the priestly class or something like that. That's why they questioned whether John the Baptist might be the second coming, or the Messiah at that time. And that's why the Divine Principle keeps warning us to seriously examine ourselves so that we can be truth seekers, like the Divine Principle mentions in the introduction. To go forth, like it said, not wandering the plains and the mountains, all that, what that means is that we should consult God through however, you know, spiritual practice we do, prayer, meditation, reflection, to be inspired by the Spirit, so that then when we look at the Word itself, we can understand, like Reverend Moon said, it's that God's interpretation rather than human interpretation. And if you went to the retreat, you know, that Moses activity was so powerful because it's like, how are we supposed to recognize him? How are we supposed to recognize him? Like, what's going on, man? He's just going crazy out here. I thought he was going crazy. But that's why the Divine Principle says we have to be open-minded through analyzing the Spirit, going forth in Spirit and truth. Not just being open-minded in a, just because like, oh, I'll accept anyone. Oh, the West treated us terribly. Hitler seems to be saying good things. Yeah, look what that did to them. Not good, not good. Which is why you need God, which is why you need, you know, to also study Scripture. Not just the Bible too, but also what are other faiths saying? Because God is trying to work through everyone. Of course, in the Divine Principle, we come from the perspective that it's Christianity that God is chiefly trying to work through today. And so we can recognize the second advent in part by our understanding of the Spirit and truth through God, and also our original mind, and also through the fruits that they produce, right? Well, remember, I think one of the qualms of mine was like, man, he's not producing any fruits. He's just saying, follow me, like, oh, but it's okay. But the thing with Jesus, love you, Manny. But I love you, Eva, for actually putting the activity together. Ooh. But in any case, Jesus did produce fruits through his miracles, but his miracles also only bewildered the crowds even more in some cases, which is why the Divine Principle said that the fruit of the second advent will be the new truth and the completed testament word that he gives. The fruit will be how his, you know, telling the Christians of his time and his place about the new truth and how it does complete the Old and New Testaments, and how to model and how to go through the completion stage together with him and his bride as the model. Now, and just to reaffirm this, it says on page 172, the divine principle says that on the earth, they will form a perfect trinity with God and become true parents both spiritually and physically. They will give fallen people rebirth, both spiritually and physically, removing their original sin, and enabling them to build trinities on earth with God as the center. So that's the nature of the fruit that they will bring. And, okay, now, the divine principle says that the new truth must come, but in the introduction, what it says actually is that this is the first volume of the new truth. In other words, it's a small part of the new truth. So who gave the new truth? Who gave this book, if we believe it's the new truth? Who gave us the understanding that originally we were supposed to go through this three-stage growing process and have good relationships centered on God through a four-position foundation and explain the symbolism of the fall and how God's been working throughout history and how all of history isn't chaos, but it's actually God's desperation to work through humanity and save us, even though it might pain him so much. And the divine principle says on page 12 that with the fullness of time, God has sent one person to this earth to resolve the fundamental problems of human life in the universe. His name is Sung Myung Moon. So we study in the unification movement the divine principle and Reverend Moon's teachings and thousands of speeches and thousands of volumes of public speaking tours and everything, because we do believe that he and him finding what's called the only begotten daughter, right? The Messiah as this only begotten son. He found this only begotten daughter, someone in the position of Eve, which is his wife, Dr. Hak Jahan Moon, to complete this purpose, to be the model for humanity. And as a child, Reverend Moon, I mean, he was like a lot of Christians at this time. He did attend the Presbyterian Church, but he questioned, why is my country being oppressed right now? Where is God? I thought I was being a good Christian. What happened? But he did what the divine principle talks about. He prayed and studied the scripture, and he would pray long, tearfully into the night. There's a story where he once cried so hard that there was like a puddle of water in his room. There was another time where he was so desperate in his prayer that he would bang the wall on his room, asking God for answers. And then his mom came in and was like, what the hell is this hole in the wall? Come on, Sung Myung Moon, come on. But this desperate heart led him to an intense experience with Jesus on Easter Sunday at age 15. And in his autobiography, he recounts that Jesus told him directly, God is in great sorrow because of the pain of humankind. You must take on a special mission on earth having to do with heaven's work. And then Reverend Moon recounted that Jesus spoke clearly about the work I would have to do. His words were extraordinary, having to do with saving humanity from its suffering and bringing joy to God. So Jesus called Reverend Moon in the same manner that John the Baptist was the returning Elijah, in the same manner that Jesus was the Messiah. Reverend Moon was called by Jesus to complete his mission as the second advent. Now, Jesus didn't at this mountain tell him like, okay, here's the divine principle, here's everything, so do your mission. With Jesus, he, in his life, it's not clear in the Bible how he understood his teaching, how he was trained in his teaching. But from the divine principle, it's clear. We understand through the spirit and truth. So for 9 years since this moment, while he was studying externally the things of the world, you know, he studied electrical engineering in university, he was studying the Bible in multiple languages, he was still praying arduously every night, tearfully. And then he had other spiritual experiences, communing with God and Jesus, where it wasn't just like, oh, is this right? No, because God wants his central figures, even the Messiah, to own his mission and to own what he's saying and to own his mission and what he's supposed to do. So when Reverend Moon, for example, was discovered through his own original mind and his communion with Jesus, the truth of the fall of man and that the origin of sin in this world is a misuse of love, he went to God and told him, and God was like, no, that's not right, go back. So he went back, he studied it again and again and again, prayed and prayed and prayed. He went to God a second time and said, no, this is right, I'm sure of it. God was like, no, you're wrong, go back. But then finally, the third time, he's like, I know this is true. Why are you telling me it's not? I believe it's true. It says here. And what he also did is he told Satan directly. He had a spiritual experience with the devil himself. And he confronted him and forced him to confess, saying, I know what you did. I know what you did to Eve in the garden. It was you, wasn't it? You basically raped her because, you know, she's a minor. She was immature and you took advantage because you're selfish means. And Satan was like, fine. And then he told God, Satan confessed. So am I right or am I wrong? And God was like, yes, you are right. And from there, he discovered not just the divine principle, but the words in his thousands and thousands of volumes of speeches. And so, like Jesus, he began his public ministry. But the mistakes that Jesus prophesied came to pass, where these spiritual groups, such as the church called Inside the Womb Church, or the Holy Lord Church, when he went up north to find followers, and he was not accepted, he went to his service, to their services, sitting there humbly, sharing what he knew and being and trying to tell them about his mission. But them and mainstream Christians, they didn't understand. So they sold him out to the communist authorities in North Korea. And he was put in prison. But what's also interesting is that he was put in prison with one of the leaders of these spiritual groups named Hyo Hyo Bin. But even though Reverend Moon desperately tried to tell her, I'm this the person you're talking about, please. Like, I'll find a way to, like, convince the gods to get you out, please. She didn't listen. And she died there. And Reverend Moon was cast on the streets. And the few followers he did have took a year to nurse him back to health. But it got worse. The rejection got worse and worse and worse. Until the communists, who the Christians were selling him out to, just like the Jews sent Jesus out to the Romans, cast him out to the be crucified by the Romans, communists were like, oh, you're a spy for the South Korean president. And he was sentenced to 3 years in a Hungnam prison labor death camp, similar to the concentration camps that the Jews endured. Communists had these camps as well. And it was said that a prisoner, even though they were sentenced for 3 years, they wouldn't last 6 months. But because Reverend Moon had absolute conviction, just like Jesus in his 40-day fast and three temptations, he had absolute conviction of his mission. Because he took responsibility for it and he found it himself, he was able to overcome and eventually escape when the U.S. troops bombed the prison and went back safely to the South to try and gather more followers. But it was still hard. Christians still opposed him, like Jesus prophesied, because he wasn't who they expected. He wasn't who they expected. They thought that he would be some respected person. Instead, he's a prison refugee with tattered clothes, and the first church he's built is a cardboard box. But still, he persevered and persevered and persevered. And because of the environment God created, even though he suffered a Hungnam labor death camp, he was able to survive. He could still begin completing his mission. And he established the Unification Movement, which was then called the Holy Spirit Association for the Unification of World Christianity. And he met this only begotten daughter that God also sent, Hak Jahan Moon. And in 1960, they began and completed the first part of their mission, which was to establish a four-position foundation together through a holy marriage ceremony centered on God, to offer physical rebirth, to offer a way where we can be not just spiritually but physically our bodies removed from the shackle of Satan, so that we have the potential to go through the completion stage together. We have the potential to form a trinity with God just like they did. And this is the importance and the reason why our movement offers and Kut is a big espouser of the blessing. Because the blessing was first modeled by Reverend and Mrs. Moon. And then they gave it first to 3 followers, then 12, and then they've been trying to spread it throughout the world. And this blessing is what invites God directly into the Four Position Foundation, rather than Satan. It's what brings God into the family, to create a God-centered family. Now, what are the fruits that Reverend and Mrs. Moon has done besides this ceremony? They have hundreds of organizations, thousands of volumes of sermons, thousands and thousands of events. He met world leaders. He embraced those who imprisoned him. My mom will talk about, Sam will talk about that in a bit. And both of them will share more how personally they've been saved by Reverend and Mrs. Moon. Because in the end, if we're not actually saved by them, they're not completing their mission, but they have saved millions of people. They have impacted the world through all the organizations, but they also have been misunderstood just like Jesus was. But because of this preparation that God has made through Christian history, they have been able to survive. And even though Reverend Moon himself passed away in 2012 at the age of 93, Mother Moon is still here. And not only that, because members of the unification movement, anyone who receives the blessing has their original sin removed, they have the opportunity to give the same thing to others, to invite God into others' people's families. And they, Reverend Moon called this the commission to be tribal messiahs, just like Jesus told his gospels to spread the good news and give the possibility of spiritual rebirth. Reverend Moon gave that to us, which is why I don't want to keep this to myself. I know everyone here. I love you guys. And some of you saw at the retreat that I don't take this stuff lightly. I feel I've done my best, and I'm not perfect, but I've tried my best to be a truth seeker, to study this book, to study their teachings, to pray to God, and then analyze their fruits and see if it's been consistent. And also ask myself if I've been saved by them. And I know whenever I've not really had a relationship with Reverend and Mrs. Moon or studied the divine principle, lived by its teachings, my mom and my family can attest I was a wreck, a total wreck, total wreck. And it's when I came back that I was saved by these people and their teachings. And so I don't want to just sit around and keep it to myself, because I do believe that this is part of God's providence of restoration. I do believe that it's an opportunity for us to build an ideal world, even if it may take a long time, even if there have been many setbacks, like there always is in the providence of restoration. This is the least I can do, but I, at the same time, don't just believe me. It's not about me and me in these diagrams. It's about being truth seekers yourselves. And part of that is having give and take action with others. We learn that energy is generated through give and take action. And so that's what we're gonna do right now with each other. Some of you may have heard this before and believe that they are this Messiah and in this position of true parents. Some of you may not have heard this before. But we all, so I invite you all to turn your chairs into a circle, because we're gonna have some discussion and some give and take, because even if, whether we believe this or not, and it's okay if we don't right now, especially since we've just heard this, you know, it's okay. But part of being a truth seeker is having give and take with other believers. And so we can do that now, so we can form a circle together. And I just want to thank you for listening, because you guys can form the circle now. Because it's a lot to hear, but it's also a great opportunity. So let's discuss together. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Thank you.